I'm Jeff.
I'm Sam, and we're part of the Google Apps education team.
So a lot of people have asked us why we decided to start building applications and really also to start offering them in an organizational or institutional context to schools and businesses. And what we saw was this trend evolving in the application space where consumer technology was evolving and innovating very, very rapidly. And so you look at the first instant messaging, the first blog, the first wiki, video sharing, mobile technologies, virtual reality, and a lot of this was really happening in the consumer space. And so we saw this increasing trend of user satisfaction, of innovation, where things were moving very quickly, and consumers were very happy with the technology they had access to at home. And then we went out and we talked to organizations and we said, what does the world look like for you? And they were really facing a variety of challenges. And the first was an explosion in the volume of information people were dealing with. There was the number of emails, the number of documents was just increasing at an exponential rate, and technology often wasn't keeping up. And so people were really struggling just to do simple tasks and keep track of all the information they now had at their fingertips. The second real challenge for users was around collaboration. And whereas most of the applications we are using today were built for personal productivity, a lot of the challenges we face today are really about collaborating in a group. When I started trying to work with my team or my class, it became really challenging. And the best example of this is just collaborating on a document. If I'm in a class and working on a group project with four of my friends, I might start with a document. And I send it out to my four friends, and three of them who are on the ball send me back some edits, and I spend an hour or two combining the edits and putting together version two. I send that back out to everybody, and my three friends spend some more time making some edits. They send it back to me. But I always have at least one slow friend. And my slow friend likes to come back and send me revisions from two or three versions before. And now I'm in a place where I'm just struggling to try and bring together the work everyone has done. This is just an example of technology that hasn't kept pace with the real challenges facing users. On the IT side, we saw a different set of challenges, really about complexity. There are solutions out here to many of these challenges, but all of them are very costly and complex to deploy and to manage. Really a nightmare for an IT folks. And so we often say, what does that environment look like for you today? And they say, well, we bought PCs, and there's some software we put on there. And then we started buying systems, email systems, directory systems, storage systems, mobile systems, content, databases, spam filtering. And then, of course, once we bought all this stuff, we realized that it's never allowed to go down as our president and our students are going to Beijing and Shanghai and Mumbai. And so we go ahead and we buy a second one of absolutely everything to make sure nothing can ever go down. And then we spend our lives just going around and patching and fixing and making sure everything works. And Patch Day Tuesday rolls around and we go again and just fix everything. And what this really meant to the institution was a lot of money that was not being spent effectively. We weren't effectively leveraging the time, the energy, and the money we were investing in information technology. The other thing it meant for our users was that whereas we had seen this increasing trend of satisfaction in the consumer space, we saw a much leveler level of innovation and satisfaction with the technologies we had access to at school. And so we at Google thought, we can really help with this problem. And if we can bring some of those Google technologies, the consumer innovation, into this space, we can bring those trends back together and help people be as happy with the technology they have access to at school as they are with the technology they have access to at home.
We want you to take this complex environment that you've been managing and replace it with an environment managed by an outside provider like Google. This provides you with all the applications simply to you, like utility, accessible from any internet connection, from any device. But this move is not without precedent. 50 years ago, companies and universities ran their own power plants. They had different voltages, currents, plugs. You couldn't take a device from one and use it anywhere else. And people thought that electricity was mission critical. How could you allow anyone else to manage it? Today, we wouldn't dream about managing our own electricity plants. What does this mean for you? As an organization, we see too much IT time and effort and money really spent on focusing on things that are not core to your business and focusing more on contextual services. This is not effective for an organization. And so basically, by moving to the Google model, you get to focus on the things that are important to you, the things that are core to your organization and that add value. We see really three key benefits in the cloud computing model. The first is that you get to leverage the infrastructure of the provider. In Google's case, this means massive data centers built for scalability, security, and efficiency. We set out to build the environment that runs Google.com. And one of my favorite antidotes is that when my users want to see if the internet's up and running, the site that they often go to is Google.com. The other key benefit of the cloud computing model is it allows a new kind of real-time collaboration that you've never been able to do before. Take the earlier document example that Jeff was talking about. In this new world, the document sits in the cloud, and everyone can be accessing and working on that document and collaborating on it in a real-time environment. The third key benefit is in the old world, you spent a lot of time installing hardware, installing and maintaining software. But really, this model is all about innovation. It's more about identity management. You plug in once and you get all the innovation delivered to you in smaller packages more frequently. So we consider ourselves a services platform and we open it up to a lot of APIs. Some of these are for things like account management, for a single sign-on, for mail migration, and we also support open standards, which is really important in our world.
When people start talking about outsourcing services and data, the first questions that they come to us with are really around privacy and security of data. I'd like to use a few examples to tell you how we here at Google think about these critical issues. The first example is my grandfather. You can see him here. He's a great guy, World War II vet. He still thinks that his money is best buried in the backyard versus being in a bank. So he actually puts it in a tin can and buries it under one of the trees in his yard. And he won't tell me which one, because he says he trusts me, but not quite that much. Now, most of us believe that our money is much safer in a bank than it is buried in the backyard, and we can get access to it from lots of places, whether that's a banking center in London or the ATM around the corner. Another great example is really travel. You know, most people feel safer driving than they do flying. When statistics tell us that you're much more likely to arrive at your destination unhurt taking a plane than you are a car. But there's just something about holding onto that wheel that makes us feel in control and more safe. And we think security of data is much the same. The reality is that though while having that infrastructure in-house makes you feel safe, a provider like Google, who operates at a much larger scale, is able to secure that data much better than you could yourself. So the question is really about privacy. What is Google doing with your data? And I'll say four things to you about privacy that are really commitments from Google. First, we won't share your data. There are some obvious exceptions to this rule provided by common sense in the law, and I'll go through those in a minute. Second, we'll keep your data as long as you like. We're not going to delete it because you haven't accessed it in so long or edited the document. On the other hand, if you want to remove your data, we'll remove it from all of our active servers, because if you don't want a copy kept, we shouldn't be keeping one either. And finally, we'll let you take your data with you wherever you want to go, whether that means exporting a document to Word or Excel or taking all of your mail and calendar data with you to another service. We're committed to helping you take that with you wherever you'd like. Now, there are a few exceptions to the first rule, and I like to go through these, calling them the fine print on the big screen. The first exception is the most obvious, when a user consents. If you ask for us to share your document or a calendar with a couple of your friends or the entire world, we'll go ahead and do that. Second, sometimes we have to provide data to affiliates or subsidiaries for purposes of processing. A great example of this is when we provide data to Google Ireland for purposes of processing in our European data centers. And sometimes we have to provide data to third parties for valid legal processes, enforcement of our terms of service, to prevent fraud, or protect against imminent threat. If you'd like to know more about Google's privacy policies, please visit google.com/privacy.
So what is Google Apps? We start with the Google Apps platform, and then we add a bunch of collaboration tools. These include Google Docs, which is our word processing, spreadsheet, and presentation tools. Google Sites, a collaborative team working environment, and the Google Personalized Start Page, a personalized ramp up to all these tools that we talk about. Then we add a bunch of communication tools, Google Mail, Google Calendar, and Google Talk. We also have a set of security and compliance tools that we can add to the package for an additional cost. So what is it that we give to education? Well, Google Apps Education Edition is free for students, faculty, staff, and alumni. There's no advertising for faculty, staff, and students. And we give you 6.5 gigabytes worth of storage, and that's growing on a daily basis. It's at your domain, and it comes with support 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We also give you access to those extensibility APIs that we mentioned that allow you to integrate with your existing system and build on top of these tools.
We think Google Apps is a great set of tools to help your students, staff, and alumni more effectively communicate and collaborate.
It allows you to simplify your infrastructure and leverage all of the great innovations that Google brings out. For more information, please visit our website.